Well, good afternoon, everybody. I'd like to get things underway. It is 3 o'clock p.m., and that is the time of our appointed council meeting this 13th day of June. I'd like to welcome members of staff, council members, and a couple of troopers there in the press box. We welcome you two gentlemen today. I just want to point out again, Judy Ann McCauley is volunteering again to run the cameras, and we very much appreciate all the time she spends volunteering for that job. Again, we are televised and web streamed. I remind everyone of that, and your cell phone gadget, if you can put it in silence mode so as to not disrupt the meeting, that will be appreciated. We have one change to the agenda. Actually, we have two changes to the agenda now. On your desk, you will see that we have revised minutes of the June 13th, 2017 Council and Committee meeting attached, and also attached to this package is staff report FS17-19, and that is the capital status report. It was distributed last week, and we will deal with that as item 8D. Any other? Councillor Height, please.
Mayor Luke, on the capital status report, I do have some questions on there, but it wasn't on our agenda, so I didn't bring it with me, and that has my questions written down on it. It should have came in our original agenda. It was a missed item. And I would ask that we defer it for 1 week so I could at least bring in my notes.
Can we defer this another week till next Tuesday? I guess that'll be up to council. I would suggest that it would be up to council to have this item deferred another week so you could bring your notes. So we get to that item, we'll discuss it. Fair enough? Okay. So it's been moved by Councillor Geisens and seconded by Councillor Oliver that the agenda be approved with the following amendment. Number one, the revised minutes of June 6, 2017 Council and Committee meeting, and also item B, the addition of staff report FS17-19, the capital status report. Any discussion? Those in favor? Opposed? Okay, that's carried, and we'll add those two items to our agenda to be dealt with later. I'll ask if there's any disclosure of a pecuniary interest. I hear none. There are no presentations, there are no deputations this evening. I'm suggesting a 6 o'clock finish tonight, and I will do my best part to keep things going. Yeah, the little chuckles out there, yeah. On page 7 of your agenda, we have an adoption and correction portion of our agenda here. We had a regular council meeting 3 weeks ago today, back on May 23rd. Is there, is there anything in those printed pages from May the 23rd that you wish to bring to my attention? Hearing none, I'll just declare those council meeting minutes adopted as they are printed. We'll go to page 22. The first item of communication is from Kim Ludwig. She is the president of the Wooden Bear L Winery Inc. Her correspondence is seeking a letter of support for sale of wine by the glass, and she would need a license for that. It has been moved by Councillor Oliver and seconded by Councillor Height that this correspondence of Kim Ludwig, president of the Wooden Barrel Winery Inc., be received as information, that the clerk be directed to communicate council's blanket support of all such applications as indicated in resolution number 13 of the May 7th, 2013 council and committee minutes. Any discussion on that? And this would be approval subject to the standard procedures that we have set out. Any discussion? I hear none, so I'll ask those in favor of this motion. That's carried. Thank you. Page 23, our second communication is from George Arugio. He is the general manager of the Norfolk County Fair and Horse Show. He is asking permission for a special occasion permit for October 6th and 7th. That's the fair in 2017, moved by Councillor Height, seconded by Councillor Geisens, at the request for the special occasion permit for the Norfolk County Fair on October the 6th and 7th, 2017, be approved, subject to meeting all required approvers. Are there any discussion or questions on this request? This is a yearly request, of course, made for a couple of their events at the grandstand. Those in favor? Carried. We'll go now to reports of committees. It's been moved by Councillor Geisens and seconded by Councillor Height that the minutes of the May 18th, 2017 special council and committee meeting be adopted as presented. I believe this was the, Okay. Official five-year plan review and discussion. Those in favor? Opposed? Carried. On now to the council and committee minutes from last Tuesday. And I just wanted to point out that last Tuesday I left the meeting at 7 o'clock. The chairman certainly was aware of that. I was asked to speak at a Lions Club meeting in Waterford, and I caved in and said yes, I would, but you fellows seemed to do really well without me. So you were actually on your way home before I was from Waterford, so it was an enjoyable evening. Anyhow, that's why I left, if you were wondering. Moved by Councillor Oliver and seconded by Councillor Geisens that the revised minutes of council and committee meeting dated June the 6th, 2017 be approved as presented, with the exception of resolutions number 3 and resolution number 23, and they are pulled for further discussion. So everything except 3 and 23. Any discussion? Not. Those in favor? Carried. I'm going to deal with resolution number 6 first, please. Whoop. Six. It's resolution 6.
Oh, that's here. That's our apple. So that's 3.
Okay, thank you. Sorry about that. Thank you. Sorry, that's the ordered number. My apologies. Okay, and that'll be found on page 32 of your agenda. So moved by Councillor Geisens and seconded by Councillor Wells. Now, there's a number of, this is the proposed natural gas infrastructure with Norfolk County possibly and Union Gas taking natural gas Turkey Point. So a number of whereases here. Do you want them read? No, you can read. So I will go down to the bottom. After the whereases, be it resolved that the County of Norfolk County formally support an application submitted by Union Gas or supplier to the government of Ontario for a grant from the Provincial Natural Gas Grant Program to expand the natural gas system in Turkey Point, and that Council supports making a financial contribution towards the proposed project in the amount equivalent to the property tax that would be recovered on the new natural gas infrastructure for a period of at least 10 years as per the Natural Gas Grant Program requirements. And finally, that a copy of this resolution be forwarded along with the application to Ontario's Natural Gas Grant Program. Discussion. Councillor Black, please.
I'm the one that had it pulled and won't support it. I know everyone else will, but my rationale is I feel that Turkey Point is already overdeveloped and that it will encourage more development and shouldn't be because it's an environmentally sensitive area. So it's my rationale.
Thank you. Councillor Columbus.
Mr. Mayor, I will be supporting it, but I have a question that's related, and it's the resolution number 4 about this fiber optic cable that should be installed at the same time. And who is going to pay for that installation? Would the county have to contribute dollars toward installation of that fiber optic cable, or is it going to be private dollars from Quick or Executive?
I don't know if I can answer that accurately. It was my I guess a guess or assumption, because we didn't really talk about that last week in the discussion, but it was my assumption that it was, this resolution was for staff to pursue to see that if this gas line did go in, that optic fiber, someone would be approached to see if they wished to put that fiber in. I didn't look at it as a cost to the county. I could be totally wrong. I don't think we really discussed it. I just thought, well, there would be a provider that may be interested, because I don't think the county installs fiber down concessions. I'm not aware of it. So, Councillor Columbus, I don't know if staff want to chip in anything or any other councillor, but I just think it was more of an investigation. Councillor Oliver, then Height, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I know Councillor Height will comment on this as well, but I think his recommendation, his motion, was very timely. I mean, if you think about it, a major part of the cost of any install under the ground will be the actual trenching. And if, why wouldn't you install the fiber optic if there's an opportunity and the trench was going to be created anyways? It seems to me, Mr. Mayor, that if this motion stays, Union Gas goes ahead and makes its application, and within a year or two, they might be given provincial approval to go ahead and put in the gas line, we may have our very first SWIFT project that we could support. And if you think about it, we've thrown our little bit of money into the game with SWIFT or through other means like the one that I think Quick and ExecuLink and Norfolk County are doing cooperatively to go down to Port Rowan now. So I think there will be opportunities where we're not going to have to put capital dollars into the game any more than we have already through our support of the SWIFT proposal, for example.
Thank you, Councillor Height.
Thank you, Mayor Louvier. I am with you on that one. I'm just looking for some options from staff to work with the proponent. I'm not exactly sure why we're discussing resolution number 4 as it wasn't pulled, but okay, with that, moving ahead, the same thing you said, to have staff come back with a report on something. I don't know who's funding it. I don't even know if it's possible, but we should look at it as we are building it on infrastructure. Thank you.
Councillor Brunton.
Thank you, Mayor Luke. I had some second thoughts on some of this. I do support it, but I was quite disappointed when we asked for the total project cost and they said they had not had the total estimate yet. And yet they have everything lined up, who's getting charged and everything. I just found it odd. I do have a sneaky feeling, and I'm going to say it, that they know exactly what it's going to cost and that the residents, the county, and I guess that's about it. When you look at it, and Councillor Oliver may be able to help me here, wasn't there a $40 charge per hookup? Is that a monthly charge or is that an annual charge?
Councillor Oliver.
Yeah, thanks, Mr. Mayor. It was an estimate of $40 per month that would be applied to their customers' bills, of new customers that chose to hook up in Turkey Point. So I think the representative said on average it would amount to potentially $500 per year.
On top of their gas bill?
That's correct.
Okay. So if you put it all together, you know, I've been involved in burying cables and so forth, but disappointed in that part of it, but I do support it because it's money we don't have yet, I guess. The other thing on Councillor Height's issue, I'd be quite surprised if any fiber optics would be buried right in the same trench as gas. I might be wrong on that, but I don't think so. And I would also suggest that perhaps staff contact these gas company and ask them to liaison with the cable companies, or get the cable companies by staff to liaison with gas. It's got to be one way or the other if you want to coordinate it. But But again, it's I think it'd be a substantial cost for the fiber anyway. So, thank
you. Okay, and certainly, Councillor Height, I agree with you. You are correct. Resolution number 4 on pursuing any funding as to fiber optic, that's already been passed in the previous motion, so thy will be done. I have shown some leniency because it is related to Resolution 3. The county manager has just mentioned to me we do have an IT advisory committee that's very active and very willing to assist in getting optic fiber going. This is an item that could be referred to them when the time comes to have their input. I think it's a very wise suggestion. That's what that committee was put together to do, so we could turn this over to them should we see fit. Anyhow, I am going to get back to the resolution number 3, which is 6 on my sheet. Any further discussion? Okay. Those in favor of resolution number 3, those in favor? And those opposed? And that is carried. And I need to put carried down here. So that you know it's carried. Okay. Thank you very much. I'm at page 46. No, I'm not. I'm on resolution, the next one. Okay. I'm ahead of myself tonight. I just said I'd try to move things along. I wasn't kidding. Let's go back to page. Thank you. Page 40. Resolution number 23. It's been moved by Councillor Wells and seconded by Councillor Geisens. That report, CSD 1714, this is the Combined Fire Emergency Management Station in St. Williams, be received as information. Also, that Council instruct the Community Services Department staff to proceed with an expression of interest for site development options in St. Williams. And further, that Council approve in principle the merging of capital project budgets for Fire Station 10 replacement and EMS Port Rowan-based replacement into a combined co-located facility in St. Williams, recognizing that final approval will be Council's discretion. Discussion. Councillor Brunton.
Thank you, Mayor Luke. Apologize for my delay in this motion, but I've had a lot of problems and I've wrestled with it, and I think that this decision in the long term could be better planned, and I've provided you with some documents I printed up or had printed up. One is on your desk, and I apologize if you have to share them. They're maps of the fire station locations and their radiuses of service somewhat. I'm sure they go out or they have mutual aid or whatever is called for. And also a small map that shows the ambulance bases, which are very interesting that they cover a lot more area than our fire service. I've also looked at the motions, Your Worship, if I may, and I want to read the one of October 3rd, 2016. And there's just two short resolutions. One, that the staff report impact on closing the fire station in St. Williams be received as information, and that Council approve the continued fire protective services offered by the St. Williams Fire Station. And I am in no way saying anything about closing a fire hall, and I support the protection services provided by the St. Williams Fire Hall. My concern is the future location, which I understand based on the motion we passed last week, is to look at a location for a suitable station that will combine St. Williams Fire Hall with the EMS. And if I may, I've got a bigger map there, and I think you all have the small one in front of you with the EMS. But whether you support it or not, I think if a long-range plan is considered for the location of this fire hall, that millions of dollars will be saved long-term. And if you look at the map, and I'm going to highlight this one here, St. William's, Fort Rowan overlap considerably. And I'm not saying to eliminate either one of them. My concern is when we plan for a new fire station, that it's located at a spot that can service both of those. And logically, in my opinion, if you look at that road to, I'm not sure what it's called, or regional road, I guess it's called the Lakeshore Road from St. Williams. And if you know where the curve is, where Backus Mill is, if you had a station and you look on that map, it's a little central to both, could service both in the future. What would this save down the line at some point if we had two fire stations and one EMS station combined? What would that save? Well, we all know a few months ago we spent $2 million buying fire trucks. Just two trucks. Again, I'm sure at some point we could eliminate some trucks. If we closed all three of those facilities at some point, there would be a good revenue, I would think, from two fire halls and a EMS station. I think it's an old house up on 59, if I'm not mistaken. I understand when there's a fire now with one of those stations, they frequently call Langton or one of the adjacent, either St. Williams or Port Rowan. They attend the same fire as St. Williams or Port Rowan. Considerable savings for the sale of the buildings. I think I touched on that. I'm not in any way trying to say close either one of these stations. What I'm trying to say is if you plan it out to build in the right spot, there could be considerable savings. And I'm not saying to lay off any firemen or get rid of any firemen. You would combine those firemen through attrition. I'm sure some will leave over a period of time. There would be a considerable savings there long term too. Gentlemen, this is good planning, and it's, to me, it's if it's a Norfolk County issue, it should not be a ward issue. It's something we should look at for all of Norfolk County, and if we could save some money, I find it very difficult with all the fire stations we have when we only have five EMS stations, when you look at the map. Anyways, Your Worship, I'd like to make an amendment to that motion, and I have it here, that consideration be given to the Port Rowan Fire Hall when locating the new St. Williams Fire Hall and EMS station. And to me, it's pretty simple, but I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
I'm just letting the clerk get that down.
Not going to cost any money to look. Thank you.
Read that proposed amendment, and I want to listen to it, please.
Just to make sure that this is the same, that consideration be given to the Port Rowan Fire Hall in considering the location of the new proposed St. Williams Fire Hall.
Now, I'm going to accept that as an amendment. I just want to say to Council as we move ahead on this resolution that I, too, went over the three recommendations that were approved back on October the 3rd, 2016. And certainly the deputation we had from Ron Walker, number one, was received by information, so that's in the books. Secondly, a motion that I had made that was passed was that And it says, and that council approve the continued fire protection services offered by the St. William's Fire Station. So it speaks specifically to the fire services that that specific Station 10 offers that they continue. My judgment is that amendment does not eliminate that motion. If it would eliminate that motion, there are a number of options. You would more than likely have to go through the notice of motion for a reconsideration, two-thirds, because the 1 year is not up. But Mr. Clerk, would you agree that the proposed amendment does not in any way change the intent of Council's motion of October the 3rd to continue the firefighting services of Station 10?
Yes, Mr. Mayor. As usual, I agree with you.
That's my boy. Thank you. And finally, the third, if I may just for a moment, the third recommendation on October 3rd was that our staff be directed by Council to prepare and bring forward a strategic review of alternate locations for the fire hall located in St. William's, and that along with the emergency medical services station, and that be brought forward to Council in 2017 to be looked at, and if a decision was made, go on to the 2018 capital budget. And again, I think that amendment clearly does not interfere with the intent of those motions. It's simply to have a look at the, tell me if I'm wrong, to look at the Port Rowan Fire Station in this study. Is that a fair statement, Councillor Brunton? Thank you. Go ahead.
I'm just saying, my understanding is we're looking for a location for the EMS and fire hall for St. Williams.
That's the intent, yes.
So why can't we consider Port Rowan at the same time, just in terms of location?
And an amendment is in order, and it'll be the decision of this council whether they want to include Port Rowan or not. Councillor Wells, we're going to speak to the amendment first, and then Councillor Oliver.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. Mr. Mayor, I wonder if we could have a comment from Mr. Cridlin on the amendment, please.
We certainly can. Mr. Cridlin, do you wish to respond to Councillor Wells?
Through the mayor to county council. Chief Terry Dix is not able to be with us tonight. I can contact him in short notice if we do need more information. But I think what staff had brought back to council last week in committee was exactly what they were we were asked for, was a location in St. Williams and not looking at Port Rowan. So if that is council's, if that's what council wants us to do next, there, it will definitely be a report. You know, there are some operational constraints that come into play right now. St. Williams plays back up to halls to the west, to the east, same as Port Rowan. So we're looking at a lot bigger operational aspects to this than just a location of a hall. We've also spent probably like the last 17 years in Norfolk County basing our certified water shuttles and underwriters insurance stuff around our existing halls to make sure that we met, the regulations put in by the NFPA, I believe. So it's a bigger step. There is more work to it than just picking a location, and I'll leave it at that.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Wells, anything further?
The questioning to Mr. Cridlin, listening to your comments, and thank you very much for those. If we include this amendment, if it is passed, will this, time-wise, what will this do? Will it in any way slow the process down in terms of safety of our freight bearers?
Through the mayor to Councillor Wells, I think that's a tough question to answer right now. We would definitely be looking at a whole relocation strategy with all the operational. We may need to bring an outside consultant in just to make sure our timelines could be met. So back to Councillor's work here, or Councillor Brunton's work with the circles, we would have to pick a location, do the circles, see how it covered that way. And then again, I keep coming back to the operational thing, because these halls being rural and volunteer basis, I mean, there is a lot of backup. When Station 10's out, Station 9 is backing up, that sort of thing. And it involves possibly five or six halls to take that one out for backup and things like that. So I can't really answer that. It's going to take some in-depth study before we can come up with the safety of it.
Thank you. Sorry, a couple of things. Before I go to Councillor Oliver and then Height, The clerk has written the amendment and given it to me. I really need a seconder to get it on the floor. I do have a mover. I now have a seconder. Councillor Geisens, just to officially continue with this discussion, I'll go to Councillor Oliver, then Height, please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. Actually, listening to Councillor Brunton, and even more so, I guess, looking at the map that he's provided to us, I think a lot of what he says resonates, and particularly when you look at the portion of the map where the Port Rowan and St. William Station, their radii, their circles overlap to the extent that they do. My question, first of all, Mr. Chair, to Councillor Brunton, I think, is what is the significance of the kilometer radius from the fire hall versus response time? Because my understanding that we've always been told by the fire department that it's minutes to get to a fire that it determines who's going to respond and who's going to serve that area. Were the circles created based on input, for example, from Chief Dix et al. As to response times, or is this strictly as the crow flies distance thing with no consideration of how long it would take a truck to travel that 8 kilometers or that 5 kilometers?
I assume this was prepared by the fire department. I asked, it says fire divisions, and I asked for this through our IT or GIS department. So I assume it was done by the fire department. But I, if I may add something, and I didn't want to get into this, but the impact is in the October report, and it refers to a lot of times and distances, but I'll read it to you, okay? Just really short, it's a paragraph. As host station, 9 structure fires, St. William's, traveled an average of 1.99 kilometers with an average response time of about 7 minutes. From time of call received until arrival, should St. William's Fire Station be closed, the next closest station to respond to these structure fires would travel an average of 6.8 kilometers. Currently, the St. William's Fire Station is meeting the NFPA 1720 standard. Well, if you look at that on the circles, if that's the criteria for those two, St. William's, then all these other fire stations, they can't meet that requirement because they cover a larger area when you look at the map. They have the radiuses drawn the same, but look at the Waterford Station. If they go out to their boundaries, it's a lot further than 2 kilometers or 6.8 kilometers. So it's I don't know. There's a lot of things in that report. If you read it again, it just doesn't add up. So
thank you. Thanks for that, Councillor. Mr. Mayor, I think I'm going to support the motion. I do agree with what the Councillor said. It really doesn't go contrary to what we approved last week in Resolution 23. It just builds on it and asks for more information, I guess. So I will support it, but my final comment, if I could, if, and this is just an observation I've made this evening, but if for whatever reason a new station was created somewhere, let's just say for a second, somewhere to the west of St. William's Station now, the one big area that it seems to me would fall outside of even the 8 kilometer radius of any station could be most of the built-up resort community of Turkey Point. And if you think about it, in terms of the density of development and the number of structures and the risk to people drowning, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, that community has to be a high-priority community, and it might be a bad thing if we moved in any way, moved a station that put the Turkey Point developed resort community outside that magical 8 kilometer radius. So that's just an observation, but I am going to support Councillor Brunton's amendment.
Thank you. Councillor Height, thank you, Councillor Oliver.
Thank you, Mayor Luke. I was under the impression that we've already gone through this step, but if the amendment is slightly different, I can't figure it out. We've had the public process. We've had the public come here and speak about the importance of the hall. We've listened to the fire chief saying that you can't remove the St. William's Hall. And in that, I have to assume that the fire chief of Norfolk County understood that he would merge to make more efficiencies, because I think that's what every department head in Norfolk County should do. Now, clearly on the map that Councillor Brunton provided, you can see if you move the St. William's Hall to the proposed location at Bacchus, you do leave out Turkey Point. I can tell you that some of my landowners in my area have told me and shown me quotes where their insurance will go from $2,000 to $4,000. So expect all of those cottages, and I know there's one listed down in Turkey Point right now, $2.4 million. Okay? Expect those phone calls, because that's what's going to happen. Our chief has come forward already. You know, we have the NFPA certificates within the eight-kilometer zone. You know, like, St. Williams has to cover Long Point as well. Otherwise, you send three stations. So you got Langton, St. Williams, and Port Rowan. Long Point, the cottages are in pretty close. They're fairly expensive pieces of real estate. Do you not want to protect the cottage properties at Turkey Point and Long Point? Because basically, by doing this, that's what you're going to do. Like, we've heard from the chief, and if his word isn't good enough, maybe we need a consultant to come forward with a report and do all of Norfolk County. You can clearly see by this map, there are some spots. No wonder Clear Creek can't be a hamlet. There's no fire coverage. And maybe that needs to be taken into consideration, and we need to set some funds aside for an entire Norfolk County fire protection study. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you very much, Councillor Columbus. This is to the amendment include the Port Rowan Fire Hall in the staff research and report back to council. Go ahead, Councillor Columbus.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. It's with respect to this map. When you look at the Victoria Station, Station 11, all the other circles, and you look at the 5 kilometer, the 5 kilometer radius circle and the 8, they actually are right from the center where the station is located. But in Victoria, it's not there. The circle should start where the fire hall is, Mr. Cridlin. So that actually would move to the west, the radius, and then Turkey Point would be covered within the 8 kilometer radius. Okay, so that the map is incorrect.
Through the mayor, I can ask when this map was put together and for what purpose. It may be purposely offset for coverage. I'm not sure of that, but that is one thing I'll get back to council on.
Well, if it's purposely offset, none of the others are offset. They're all where the fire hall is.
Well, we'll see if we can get an answer why that fire station is not the center of the radius. Well, there you got your answer. It's the old station downtown Victoria. No longer there. Okay. I have Councillor Black, please. To the amendment.
I commend Councillor Columbus for seeing that. I didn't really notice it, but I think it is probably from the old fire hall. And if it was moved over to where the new one is, there probably would be coverage in Turkey Point. Anyway, I'm going to support the amendment. And I've always been concerned, Mayor Luke, about the coverages. And I guess living in an ideal world, you know, if we could have started fresh, we would have located them all in the perfect locations. And we did talk about, and I raised the issue before, about hiring a consultant to see where the most advantageous locations for all our emergency services would be. Council didn't support that because of money. And I guess realistically, if we did have that study done and it indicated that the locations were different, would we, as a council, be prepared to spend all the money to move, buy land, and all that? Probably not. So in the end, what would the point be of doing such a big study? But when you look at these concentric circles here, and I know Councillor Sonneberg has raised the issue before, it certainly looks like it's over coverage and not as many inhabitants per square mile or whatever as some of the urban built-up areas. So I think it is at least worthwhile looking at, and I will support the amendment.
Okay, the amendment has been moved and seconded, and it goes like this: that consideration be given to the Port Rowan Fire Hall in considering the location of the new proposed St. Williams Fire Hall and EMS station. And I'm going to call the question, unless there's any other comments. I think some of this debate comment would be good when we get the staff report in the future and get some facts of the pros and cons. But in the meantime, Councillor Brunton and then Sonnenberg to the amendment.
Yes, just another point, and to my good colleague, Mr. Height. I don't think we are planning a fire station next year. I just don't see it. We don't have, I don't think they have drawings or anything like that. But this is a planning tool, and I think it's common sense, good planning to look at it while we got the chance. We got two fire halls in St. Williams and Port Rowan, and I guess you got one out in Frogmore, is it, or Fairgrounds, sorry. You know, we have coverage, and I think they work well together. And I'm not, this may be years away, but I think it's a good planning tool. And Your Worship, if I may, could I ask for a recorded vote?
Yes, you can. Councillor Sonnenberg.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. As you all know, I've been an advocate of this ever since I can remember and have gotten nowhere, and I'm going to support the amendment tonight. You know, the big factor here is, as it always is, well, of course, safety and coverage is important, but money. If you go through your budgets over the last year, you'll see how much more it costs every year to fund our fire departments because the equipment is so expensive. I remember when a fire truck cost $400,000+. Now it's up to $800,000. In a couple of years, every truck we buy is going to be $1 million. And we're told that we don't have a whole lot of choice. There's only so many suppliers, and they all make Rolls Royces. Nobody makes a Ford. You know, they're all expensive, chrome-plated, and sirens and lights and leather interiors and computers. We don't have a lot of selection. We can't buy a working truck, fire truck, you know. They're too elaborate and too expensive. So the only way we're going to save is maybe cut back on a fire station because we can't save on the equipment. We don't have that much of a choice of suppliers, and we're kind of bound by what's out there. So this, to me, is a way to save some money and still supply the coverage and safety that our residents deserve. Thank you.
Mr. Clerk, do you want to go ahead and do the recorded vote, please?
Councillor Brunton.
Yes.
Councillor Black.
Yes.
Councillor Wells.
Yes.
Councillor Sonnenberg.
Yes.
Councillor Height.
No.
Councillor Geisens.
Yes.
Councillor Columbus.
Yes.
Councillor Oliver.
Yes.
Mayor Luke.
No.
The amendment carries 7-2.
Thank you. So that carries the amendment. Thank you, Mr. Clerk. And now back to the original motion, which I think, if my memory's good, is number 23. Pretty close, 23. So I'll call the question on that as amended. Those in favor, as amended. That is carried. Thank you. On to page 46, moved by Councillor Wells, seconded by Councillor Columbus, that the minutes of the May 8th, 2017 Port Dover Harbor Museum Advisory Committee be received as information. Any discussion on the minutes printed on page 46 and 47? I hear none. I will call the question. Those in favor? That's carried. Thank you. Yeah, go ahead. I'm sorry.
A little slow on the draw here. But I did want to say we're very pleased to see that we got a grant of $10,000 in item number 8. Thank you.
Thank you. Page 48 and 49, it has been moved by Councillor Wells, seconded by Councillor Columbus, that the minutes of the May 29th, 2017 Tourism and Economic Development Advisory Board meeting be received as information. Any discussion here? Councillor Wells, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Mr. Mayor, I'd like to draw Council's attention to 6.1. And as I read that, I was quite surprised that all boards of trade and all chambers were not in attendance at this meeting. And just bring that to the... I'm disappointed. Thank you. 6.1.
Good point. Yes, a good meeting. Councillor Black, please.
Yeah, just on that one, I know the Simcoe BIA general manager was in attendance and did report back to the BIA meeting his disappointment as well that not everyone was in complete attendance. Just wondering, if we go back up to 2.1, Adam Vieri provided an update on the South Coast Business Coalition. And where is this at? It's been over a year now. Are we expecting anything to come back? Does any staff member know? I don't know if Chris knows or not, if they're coming back with any type of report, recommendations that would be helpful for this council to consider and implement?
Through Mr. Mayor, no, staff have been in contact with them. I know a number of councillors have over the last few months anticipated some sort of report or feedback, but we understand there's nothing forthcoming at the present time.
Nothing forthcoming? No, well, that I got to say, that's very disappointing and a big waste of time for, after a whole year. I think this council did have a motion moved by Councillor Oliver, seconded by myself, that this council do something. It was intercepted by Adam Vieri and subsequently by the South Coast Coalition to allow them, the private sector, to do something. And we were hopeful as a council that perhaps they would come back with something, and then there was no need for council's direct involvement. But maybe we better, I wondered if the clerk, what would be the status of Councillor Oliver's motion, he seconding that, is that still sort of in limbo on the books? Could it be brought back? Maybe if you can't answer that now, you could answer it later.
We'll look into that. You'll look into it. I think you raised a good point. Councillor Oliver?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. First of all, on that same point, I'm really glad my colleague brought this up, and I too share your disappointment if Chris is just relaying, don't shoot the messenger, obviously, if this is what the South Coast Business Coalition is saying. I think we should direct staff to make a direct inquiry of the Business Coalition via the Chamber of Commerce and say, what is the status of the Downtown Revitalization Initiative, and when will you be coming and reporting to Norfolk County Council on your conclusions and recommendations? They were here once. Mr. Freiberger spoke and was enthusiastic about some things they were doing on. That's got to be, what, Mr. Mayor, 10 months ago now, perhaps a year ago almost, and it's been silence since. And that is not acceptable. So I think we need to be proactive, if council agrees, to direct staff to contact them and say, please respond ASAP as to your time frame to come back here and report.
Thank you, Councillor Oliver, and the clerk has nodded that he will be getting an answer back on
Thank
that.
You. May I bring another point up from the minutes?
Absolutely.
Since I got the floor. Mine is relating to 2.2, when Mr. Cridland reported to the TDAB about the community services review. I was going to ask this question, Mr. Mayor, under other business, because I see he gave us an info memo about it, and I will defer to that, but at least I'll wait till then to bring it up. But I have some concerns over some of what seems to be getting included in this review. So, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Anything else on these minutes? If not, I'll call the question. Those in favor? It's carried. We'll go now to staff reports. There are four on our agenda. So let's turn to page 50, please, and we'll start with our first report. It is the award of application of recycled asphalt. The report number is PW 1748. Lee Robinson, could you give us the staff report, please?
Certainly. Through the mayor to council, before you this evening is the report for the award of the recycled asphalt contract. Staff are recommending that it be awarded to Norjohn in the amount of $270,375. There are sufficient funds in the approved budget, and I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you very much. Councillor Black.
Just through you, Mayor Luke, to Lee, could you explain the whole idea of recycled asphalt? I suppose I wouldn't mind a refresher course, and maybe the general public would like to understand it a little bit better. What happens with the recycled asphalt?
Through the mayor to council, if council wishes, I can certainly provide a memo that updates the variety of different methods that we would use if that would be more desirous. But In summary, just for the purposes of recycled asphalt, basically we are using the existing asphalt that's actually removed and then placed back on the road, and then a new surface is placed on top of that. So we're reusing the material that we currently have as a way to build up our road, and it's a cost savings measure, and it definitely prolongs the longevity of a road.
Well, I think the general public likes to hear the words cost savings, so I appreciate it.
I think council does too. If I may, just before I go to my two colleagues here, Lee, a question I have on that is when you say recycled, it's when they lift the material, it's ground up, and then I call it mix it with the glue, and then glue it back down. Is that a fair, simple analogy?
Yes, that would be a fair analogy.
Okay, I've seen the machines. It's kind of neat, nice recycling. Councillor Oliver Hyde and Sonnenberg.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. My question to Lee is in regards to the single tender that was received or single bid. I'm sure there were valid reasons why the other bid was rejected. It's always a little more difficult for council to approve a tender or a bid when we only have one. So I would just like to ask Ms. Robinson, can she give us her professional opinion that the bid that this contractor has submitted is a good one, it's competitive, it's comparable to jobs that they may have done for us in the past in terms of per square meter of asphalt, et cetera. As long as she's happy that it's a really good bid, or at least a good bid, then I'm okay with it too.
Through the mayor to council, yes, I can confirm. We've worked with this contractor before. We have no objections to their work. And the price that we're receiving for this is comparable to previous years where they've also done work for us. So we're satisfied that this is a reasonable price for the work that's being undertaken. Council will see a report coming forward in the next few weeks where staff actually don't feel that the prices are appropriate, and we are recommending that it not be awarded as a result of that.
Thank you, Councillor Height.
Thank you, Mayor Luke. Through you to Public Works, I see by the price points you got, it comes in at like $6, $5.75, and $6.25. I would expect the $6 because it's a small estimated square meter size, but then there's a higher price for the Lynn Valley Road. Do you know why that was?
Through the mayor to council, a lot of the work depends on the existing conditions of the road. So for example, anywhere that there's multiple overhead wires crossing, we see a considerably higher price because it affects the contractor's ability to just basically effectively have a train and go forward. Excuse me. So it's usually its existing road conditions, the proximity of ditches.
Sorry. My apologies. I almost lost the...
The proximity of ditches, the proximity of hydro poles, driveways in the area, et cetera. There's a whole variety of factors that go into the appropriate costing.
Okay, and my final question is, what's the lifespan between this versus tar and chip or pavement?
Through the mayor to council, the life expectancy of asphalt, like a regular asphalt surface versus this, is the same. It's actually the same product. We're just, instead of using virgin aggregate, we're reusing an existing aggregate. So that is about the same. Tar and chip is not a hard surface. It's actually a dust control mechanism. So it's sort of hard to compare asphalt to tar and chip because it's basically a gravel road versus an asphalt road. Tar and chip is simply a dust control thing that we don't have to apply on an annual basis.
So with that, we could use this instead of pavement on every other road?
It depends on the condition of the existing asphalt, whether or not it's something that we can use as a recycled product. We do typically do it as many times as we do. It can only be done once. And then the aggregate, so we can only use the recycled material once before it really isn't a product that we can place down anymore. But it's something certainly that staff look to use in every opportunity that we have to place recycled asphalt.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Sonnenberg.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I think you've all heard me complain about the condition of the county line down where I live between Haldeman and Norfolk, and I see that we've begun work there. We have lines painted along the road where the shoulders are going to be tore up and replaced. I'm just wondering if this would be a probable location for recycled asphalt to repair those shoulders. And if so, can that be done on location, or is that stuff hauled away and stockpiled? and brought back as pavement?
Through the mayor to council, everything has to be looked at on an individual basis, and I believe that they considered it for those locations at the county line, but it wasn't going to be a material product that they could use there. I believe that we may be bringing in some recycled asphalt from some of our other projects for shoulder material in that area, but it hasn't been confirmed yet.
Thank you. Councillor Broughton.
Thank you, Mayor Luke. Just quickly, Lee, I heard you mentioned the base course. You're putting a top course on all these roads?
There'll be a wear course that's placed on top of the recycled asphalt.
Okay, and so on the recycled stuff, do you add some AC as they're doing it a little bit, or is that straight recycled?
No, we will add some AC to ensure that it binds together properly.
Okay, thank you. I just wondered about Lynn Valley. I know it's old tar and chip, and I'm just wondering, so you're going to, it's going to have basically the old lift and the new lift. Am I right then?
Correct, and we will augment that with some existing asphalt that we are recycling from a different county project.
Okay, very good. I'll move the report, Mayor Luke.
It's been moved by Councillor Columbus, seconded by Councillor Wells. That staff report 1748. This is the award of application of recycled asphalt be received as information, and that the General Manager of Public Works and Environmental Services be authorized to execute this contract with Norjohn Contracting and Pavement Limited for the request of a tender for the application of recycled asphalt for a one-year term. The cost is $270,375. Any further questions or comments, debate? If not, those in favor of this tender award, that is carried. Thank you very much. Our next report, staff report, is on page 53. This is the staff report 17-41. It concerns our annual energy report for this year. Lee, I think you're going to do this as well. Yes, you are. Thank you.
Certainly, through the mayor to council. Before you is our annual energy report for 2016. I'm pleased to say that we're well on our way to meeting our targets, and that we've seen nothing but positive results with respect to this program, and I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Councillor Black, questions, and then Councillor Brunn.
I really don't have any questions. I was going to move the report. It's probably moved by somebody already.
Well, we do it in writing at council, and but we do the staff report questions first, and then I get to the written motion. Okay?
I'll just wait. Yeah.
Pardon? Yeah, you already have it moved and seconded, and you'll speak to it then. Okay. This is question period on the staff report. Then we'll get to the motion. Councillor Wells, please. Sorry, Brunton, and then Wells. My apologies.